So I'm going to talk about when rectal cancer, where actually we can avoid surgery in some of these patients, which is the other end of the spectrum in terms of rectal cancer, as I recently talked about lateral node dissection. I'm going to start my presentation saying that until now, the majority of patients with rectal cancer who ever underwent organ preservation or whoever achieved a complete clinical response did so by accident, by chance. Why accident? Well, because most of these patients had locally advanced disease anyways. So these patients required chemoradiation therapy to treat locally advanced disease, and by accident achieved or developed a complete clinical response to chemoradiation therapy, and then underwent organ preservation strategies. Well, let me define you what a complete clinical response is, and the definition of a complete clinical response goes through three main pillars. Pillar number one is digital rectal examination, which is a crucial part of the assessment of tumor response and should be done by an experienced colorectal surgeon. Pillar number two is endoscopic assessment, and you should be able to see something like this: a white scar, no real ulceration, no residual mass or irregularity within the rectal wall to call it a complete clinical response. As a matter of fact, many people think that we should routinely biopsy these scars. And you have to be careful, because a negative biopsy is not part of the definition of a complete clinical response. Be careful, because a negative scar is by no means equal to a complete clinical response. So be careful with negative endoscopic biopsies. Now, the third pillar of the definition of a complete clinical response is the radiological assessment tool. Now, in the beginning, we used to use MRI or any type of radiological assessment to assess the mesorectal compartment. The mesorectal compartment is impossible to feel with your finger or to see with endoscopy. So we needed something to assess the mesorectal compartment. However, as radiology has improved significantly, currently radiologists can tell us whether there is a complete response within the primary rectal wall itself by looking at the scar. So when they see this low signal intensity area within the area of the primary tumor, they can pretty much state that this is a complete clinical response in terms of radiological assessment. So message number one here is, if you're interested in organ preservation, if you're interested in not operating these patients, well, you probably need a combination of studies. There is no perfect study. You need a combination of tools. And whenever you have combination of information provided by different tools, you probably have the best accuracy in identifying what a complete clinical response is. So that's message number one. Message number two is, it takes time for these patients to achieve a complete clinical response. If you look at our own data, the majority of patients who achieved a complete clinical response did achieve a complete response only after 16 weeks from chemoradiation completion. As a matter of fact, the average interval for the achievement of a complete clinical response was 21 weeks. So you probably need time. The majority of patients will not achieve a complete clinical response within 6 or 8 weeks like this patient. The majority of patients will look like this one, where you have a primary tumor, a near complete response in the first assessment, and eventually in the second reassessment, you will probably be able to see a complete clinical response. So message number two, it does take time. And here you can see, it really depends on the primary baseline stage. More advanced disease will probably take more time for patients to achieve a complete clinical response, whereas patients with more early disease will probably take less time for the achievement of a complete clinical response. However, even so, the average time is pretty long. So patients usually take time for the achievement of a complete clinical response. Now the question is, why don't we operate on these patients? Simple TME would probably deal with the problem, right? Well, we are trying to achieve something here, and the idea is to avoid the significant morbidity, the relative mortality, and even the functional consequences associated with this procedure, not to mention the need for temporary stomas among these patients. So this is why we strictly survey patients whenever they achieve a complete clinical response. Now, this very intensive follow-up program is particularly intensive during the first 3 years of the achievement of a complete clinical response. Why? Because there is a risk of a local regrowth. The majority of surgeons fear the risk of a local regrowth. Yes, because local regrowth, which is the recurrence of the tumor within the primary rectal tumor area, is quite frequent. One in out of every four patients will probably have a local regrowth despite the achievement of all criteria of a complete clinical response. And these are the most robust data that we have so far, showing that the local regrowth rate is around 25-30% in the majority of these series. Now, it's interesting though that this risk of local regrowth plateaus after 3 years. This means that intensive follow-up needs to be kept for at least 3 years. Now, here you can see some interesting data. If you achieve a complete clinical response and sustain it without a local regrowth for 3 years, then the risk of a local regrowth is less than 5%. So you need to achieve and sustain a complete clinical response, and only after 3 years that the risk of local regrowth is significantly decreased. Now, I have some interesting news for you. Whenever you have a local regrowth, the majority of local regrowths will have an endoluminal component. Now, if they have an endoluminal component, it means that the endoscopy and your digital rectal examination will be able to detect the majority of these local regrowths. Yes, you may have an exclusively mesorectal regrowth. Well, in those cases, MRI will be able to detect them. That's the reason why MRI is so important during the surveillance of these patients, particularly, again, during the first 3 years of follow-up. I have some other good news for you. We know about risk factors for the occurrence of a local regrowth. Baseline T stage is the main determinant in the risk factor for a local regrowth. When you have early stage disease, the risk of local regrowth is much lower than patients with more advanced disease. Now, this is an interesting data from multiple studies put together, and you can see here that the risk of local regrowth progressively increases as you increase from T2 to T3 and to T4, 20, 30, and 40% of local regrowth risk according to the baseline T stage. Now, again, the T stage risk factor becomes irrelevant as a complete clinical response is achieved and sustained. So the risk factor for a local regrowth, looking at baseline T stage, is only relevant for the first year. If patients have gone through the first year and have not developed a local regrowth, then baseline T stage becomes irrelevant. Nodal stage is not relevant. So far, there is no study showing that a nodal stage at baseline is a risk factor for local regrowth. Why? Because the majority of local regrowths are endoluminal, meaning that the T stage is more relevant than N stage for the risk of a local regrowth once patients have achieved a complete clinical response. Message number three Well, when you have a local regrowth, you can still salvage these patients. And usually the majority of these patients are salvageable, but not only that, you can usually perform the same operation you were going to do in the beginning. So if the patient was a candidate for an APR and you have a local regrowth, you probably need an APR. But if the patient was a candidate for sphincter preservation, you can still go back and do the same operation you intended to do in the beginning. Now, there is, in select patients, the opportunity to do salvage for local regrowth with local excision, yes. And these patients were particularly the ones who had early stage disease in the beginning. So if you have early stage disease in the beginning and you have a local regrowth, these patients are more likely to have a second opportunity for organ preservation with the use of a local excision of the local regrowth itself. Now, what about metastatic disease? This is also a main concern with the watch and wait strategy. Well, if you look at the incidence of metastatic disease, it is no different from patients who undergo radical surgery for a complete pathological response. So the incidence is overall the same. Now, if you break these patients into groups or subgroups, then there's a difference. If you look at this slide, you will see that patients who have a complete pathological response, the risk of metastasis is low. In patients who have a complete clinical response and never have a local regrowth, the risk is also very low. However, among those patients who have an apparent complete clinical response followed by a local regrowth, then these patients, where you salvage by radical surgery, these patients appear to be at a higher risk for the development of distant metastasis. Now, I began my presentation saying that the majority of patients underwent watch and wait so far by an accident, because they required chemoradiation therapy anyways. These patients had locally advanced disease. But now there's an opportunity for intentional watch and wait. Patients who otherwise would not require chemoradiation therapy, but who have low risk features, would probably benefit from undergoing chemoradiation therapy for the purpose of achieving a complete response. So we're intentionally giving patients with early rectal cancer, such as T2 and NOT disease, who are otherwise very low, very distal in the rectum, who would probably benefit from chemoradiation therapy. Well, now we are in the era of TNT, and chemoradiation therapy in the classical regimens are probably already dead. We're probably using total neoadjuvant therapy. And remember, the idea of total neoadjuvant therapy is to provide all of the treatment before surgery to provide the best chances of survival and the best chances of response. Now, you can do either induction chemotherapy or you can do consolidation chemotherapy to improve response. And apparently, the only data that we have so far is provided by the preliminary data from the OPRAH trial. Now, in that trial, patients were compared in terms of two TNT regimens, induction chemotherapy versus consolidation chemotherapy. Now, the primary endpoint was a complete clinical response and TME-free survival. Surprisingly, patients who underwent consolidation chemotherapy with chemoradiation therapy long course had the best chances of achieving a complete clinical response. So we're talking a paradox here. We're trying to tell you that early stage disease didn't even need chemoradiation therapy. And now we're going to treat these patients very aggressively with TNT for the single purpose of achieving a complete response. Is this really beneficial? Well, we particularly looked at patients with early stage disease. You can see here, T2 and NOT disease, who underwent either the classical chemoradiation regimen or the TNT regimen with consolidation chemotherapy. And you can see that patients who underwent TNT were more likely, two times more likely, to achieve a complete clinical response and never undergo a radical surgery. So it seems that it does pay off to provide these patients with TNT, even though they have early stage disease. So in summary, now we have clear clinical, endoscopic, and radiological criteria to what is a complete clinical response. Yes, the follow-up is critical. Yes, it has to be intensive, at least for the first 3 years. But isn't it always critical? Well, early detection of recurrence and proper salvage seems to not affect the oncological compromise. So you have to follow these patients quite significantly to detect the local regrowth, to manage local regrowth. Apparently, there is no impact in the risk of systemic disease. But be careful, because when you break out into groups, patients with a local regrowth are at high risk for a distant metastasis and for a distant relapse. Finally, TNT is here to stay. And if you're interested in a complete clinical response and organ preservation, consolidation chemotherapy and long course chemoradiation therapy is the only evidence that we have that is associated with a higher chance of a complete response and more genuine. And finally, early stage is also interesting and also useful. So if you're thinking about early stage and TNT or early stage and organ preservation, yes, TNT may provide the best chances to achieve and sustain a complete clinical response. And even if you have a local regrowth, you may still have the opportunity to provide these patients with an organ preserving strategy with a local excision. So to end my presentation, how do we treat these patients? And when do we avoid rectal cancer surgery in mid and distal rectal cancer? Well, in mid-rectal cancer, I would say only for high-risk patients, it's really still accidental watch and wait. Those patients who would require chemoradiation therapy anyways and eventually achieve a complete clinical response. However, for the distal rectum, for those patients who have rectal cancers that are easily accessed by the digital rectal examinations, these patients will probably benefit from TNT, both in high-risk patients for accidental watch and wait, but also for early cancers where the intentional watch and wait may be an interesting alternative. Now, I have to end my presentation with giving full credit to my boss, who really challenged the role of radical surgery among patients with rectal cancer. And this is not her specific statement. This is something was already present, but it does apply to the situation here. But a good surgeon knows how to operate. A better surgeon knows when to operate. But perhaps the best surgeon knows when not to operate on patients with rectal cancer. Well, thank you very much again.